Hello and a warm welcome to the second installment of our Today live show right here on Instagram and TikTok as well. My name is Elizabeth Neo and I am your host. I'm very glad that you can join us this Friday evening as we talk about issues that matter to you. Remember, we're also going to be showing this next few Fridays at 8 p.m. Now today we're going to talk about racism, how we can move beyond a society that is just tolerant and one that doesn't judge others based on their race or ethnicity. And to help me unpack that today, I have Jun Sen. He's a correspondent at Today, and he's covered a range of issues, including politics and social affairs. I also have Mohamed Imran Mohamed Taib. He is a founding board member of the Center for Interfaith Understanding. He's also one of Singapore's most respected thought leaders on religious issues. And last but not least, Laavanya Kathiravelu. She is assistant professor in sociology at NTU, and she is an accomplished scholar on race and ethnicity. And just like last year, we've got plenty of prizes to give away. All you have to do is stay with us until the end of the episode. We have a question at the end, and all you have to do is message us with the correct answer, whether you're on TikTok or Instagram, and you can win these prizes. So the first three people to message us with the correct answer will win a $25 GrabFood voucher, as well as a Google Home Mini. And the next five people to message us with the correct answer will win a $25 GrabFood voucher. And of course, throughout the chat, we want to hear from you. Drop us your questions, your comments, and we'll get our guests to answer them. Well, let's begin. Today we're going to talk about, firstly, addressing racism and religious intolerance at home and across generations. Now, I want to bring up this result from a survey that we conducted last month. This one is on racism during the pandemic. So, 64% of our respondents feel that racism in Singapore has increased since the pandemic. Well, guys, I think the big question here is, what's behind the rise in racism incidents?
Well, thank you for joining us, audience. And I think that's an interesting result that we've gotten from the findings as well. I mean, few can really forget what happened earlier this year. In May and June, we see instances that have really become very high-profile incidents of racism taking place. Few can forget the incident where a lecturer confronted an interracial couple on the street, you know, to ask them really hurtful kind of, give them really hurtful kind of comments. And after that, we've seen a deluge of such incidents coming out. And in fact, these statistics do bear out that there have been a rise of reported incidents of racism. In 2018, there were 18 that were made to the police, 18 of such reports made to the police, and that became 31 in 2019 and 60 in 2020. So I do wonder if it actually coincides with what we are seeing with the pandemic, you know. It kind of coincides with what happened at the start of the year when we started to see the emergence of the Delta variant of the virus, and we started to see the first incident of that Indian woman who was actually doing a brisk walking near Choa Chu Kang, and she was attacked by a Chinese man on the street. So I wonder if the pandemic has actually led to more people to feel comfortable to talk about things that actually should not be spoken out in the open, right? I wonder if it has led to people to basically verbalize thoughts that should really be kept shut. And we're seeing that with all the debates that have been going on with the comprehensive agreement that we have with India, and all these things have been debated about quite strongly in Parliament even. And it's interesting to note that more and more people are more willing to put out some of what they've experienced before online. So all these have led to a confluence of events that has happened in 2021. We see a lot of debate going on about it, and we're also seeing emerging incidents come out too. I do hope to hear more what the other panelists have to say about all these incidents and help us make a sense of what's going on.
Yeah, I will agree with Jun Sen's point that the pandemic has really brought up some interesting concentration of issues, and that includes racism. And I'm also glad that we have moved beyond asking whether there's racism here in Singapore or not. I think we have to acknowledge that there's always been racism, but what we are seeing is a public discussion of it right now. And I'm wondering also whether there's, it's got to do with intergenerational issue too, because there are those who have lived through the riots, and therefore coming from a period of trauma, they would not want to relieve those experiences, and even to talk about it is something that is to be avoided. And then there's a whole generation that live in a period where corrections were trying to were being made to move beyond the racial riots in order to establish racial harmony, and that goes through the curriculum and the school system. And if you remember in the 1990s, one of the shared values is actually a racial and religious harmony, right? So we've learned not to discuss it openly because it might bring up a certain trauma, and at the same time also not knowing how to handle it well. So it's best to sweep it under the carpet and not talk too much about it, but to just keep on emphasizing the ideals of it, racial and religious harmony. But I think we have a new generation now that is emerging, and they are comfortable talking about it. That has got to do with social media, which is a game changer also. A lot of instances now are being put up on social media, and people are now sharing the experiences. That led to a kind of snowballing effect also, because as one person shared the experience, another one confirms it, hey, I had a similar incident or experience, and eventually it snowballed to the point where we can't hide it anymore, and we have to talk about it openly, because not talking about it is even more dangerous, because then people don't have the tools to discuss it and how to discuss it.
Yeah, completely agree with both of you. And I think the fact that the survey was done with millennials is also interesting, right? Like you mentioned, Imran, it's younger people who I think are more aware about racism. And so maybe it might not be necessarily a rise in racism, but more people being aware of it, willing to talk about it, and therefore post about it, report it even, which is why we're seeing rise in statistics, as well as perhaps, you know, rise of cases of racism on social media, right? So I think the demographics of who is reporting about this, who's creating awareness about this is interesting, and also perhaps the global nature of social media, right? We see, for instance, a lot of young people learning about social movements like Black Lives Matter, Me Too, and this is creating a kind of okay, global resonance around awareness of issues of racism. And I think perhaps that's also why we're seeing more talk about it on social media, but also offline.
And that's true. And also, we want to talk more about that. But I also want to bring up something that, you know, talking about the incidents, the experiences. So take a look at this chart. It's on the experience, racism experiences here. So 43% of respondents say that they have personally experienced racism. And actually, when we break it down further, over 60% of Malay and Indian respondents say they have personally experienced racism. So, you know, putting aside the incidents that we've seen, you know, making the headlines, as Jun Sen's brought up, you know, as an individual, how do we, you know, begin to address these issues?
I think it starts off with recognizing that it exists, and it exists particularly, it's particularly acute for certain community groups, especially minorities. And beyond just recognizing that it exists, we also need to know that it causes actual real hurt and trauma to people who are victimized by racist acts. And because of that, because of these incidents that have been brought to the fore, there is also a need to really find the blind spots that we might have and talk about them, because not everyone might realize what they are doing is a racist act. So I think what the pandemic has also shown is, and I wonder if this has been studied also, the fact that everyone is cloistered and held up at home in a quarantine and trapped into their own little social groups in silos at home, has it really led to this emergence of what people are not supposed to say but now they're saying? You know, and if they do that, then what is the onus on the people around them at the home setting to try to point it out and call it out? And I think a lot of it has to do with casual racism that is happening at the home setting, that you do need to come and talk about it and address it.
But how
right
do you
at the heart.
Like? Say, you know, we know this, you know, it's among the older generation. I don't, maybe it doesn't come from a bad place, but But how do you, you know, tell them that this is not okay?
Mm.
How do you get them to see why this is not okay thing?
But going back to the earlier point about the findings of the survey, frankly, I'm not surprised, and it's to be expected, especially coming from a member of a minority race, right? I mean, I personally also have experienced many of this casual racism.
Mm.
And let's admit it that in Singapore, of course, racism is a spectrum, right? And most of the cases of racism that we are hearing and we are reading online has got to do with stereotypes.
Mm.
And this has been confirmed in several studies also. Mm. Casual racism, stereotyping, yeah, is very prevalent here in Singapore. And of course, when it comes to stereotyping, it cuts across all the races, right? But here we have to understand racism as not just a standalone thing, but it intersects with a lot of other factors.
Mm.
And if you look at the demographic, let's say a member of a minority race, and it intersects with, let's say, their socioeconomic conditions, then the stereotypes have a bigger impact compared to someone of a different socioeconomic status. Of course, it intersects also the experience of gender and many other intersections, right?
Mm.
So someone who is from a low socioeconomic status and trying to apply for a job, for instance, and then plays out, the stereotype plays out, like, for example, oh, you're not suitable for this job because probably it's not mentioned openly, but at the back of the employer's mind, maybe certain stereotypes play out.
Mm.
And eventually that will impact and the person might see that as an instance of racism. And if it keeps on happening over and over again, then it confirms the person's perception that there is racism at work. And this is something that we have to really tackle and address eventually.
I think it could work the other way as well. We see, for instance, with the example of Indian migrants and the anti-seeker sentiment, a lot of it,
yeah,
is directed against elite Indian migrants, right? So even someone of a higher socioeconomic status could be, you know, the subject or object of racism because of their nationality, their immigration status, and their race, right? The intersection of those factors, even though they might be, you know, quite elite migrants or, you know, higher in socioeconomic status. So yeah, I think it works in these complex ways, right?
Because at the bottom line, it's about jobs also.
Mm.
It's about job security. It's about the anxiety within this whole economic climate. And that explains also why in the pandemic situation, when people are losing jobs and all that, they play out on these stereotypes.
Yeah.
Mm.
And Singaporeans will look at foreigners taking away the jobs, for example.
Mm. Yeah.
And the way they explain it is through the racial lens that they have grown up and getting used to.
Mm, mm. And that's where the value of having all these open discussions with close people close to you,
yeah,
you know, to try to unpack some of these issues that they have and not let it manifest in all these racist acts that we do see because of all these brewing kind of concerns. But I understand that, of course, it is very hard to unpack these things with close ones, you know, at the dinner table. It doesn't make for a particularly good conversation topic, right? But I think it has to be done, you know, because this is an issue that if we do not get it right, then there are certain risks that we have as a society.
I think it's happening, actually, already. I hear, you know, from people I talk to that younger generation think, you know, I have to say this to my parents because, you know, they made this remark, or my grandparents. And I think, you know, the younger generation are more aware of the ways of talking about race in a language that is respectful, and they're more willing to educate, you know, their parents and grandparents. So I think, you know, we see this happening already.
Mm.
Yeah, perhaps we need to, you know, talk about how stereotypes can actually, of course, as you mentioned, right, it can cause a more severe effect. So at this point, we have a question from our viewer on Instagram. At Johnny159 asks, are racial stereotypes and racism the same thing? Are they both equally acrimonious?
No, I don't think they're the same thing necessarily. But, you know, negative stereotyping leads to racism, as Imran pointed out, right? We can also have very positive stereotypes that can work in the interest of a community, right? But of course, all stereotyping is about essentializing a group, you know, saying there are these characteristics that this group represents. So it's problematic because it's a generalization, it's not true of every member of the group. So I think we need to be skeptical of stereotyping, no matter which what form it takes.
But I fully agree. I mean, we have that's why we have to have a discussion on what constitutes racism. For me personally, I see racism as a spectrum. And of course, stereotyping is part of it at the one end of the spectrum. Of course, we cannot see racism as something that manifests only in the worst forms. Yeah, sometimes it could be in a benign form, in the sense that racism is about essentializing that you belong to a particular race, and therefore you must have you must have the characteristic of certain traits. You must have certain traits and characteristics, and then you are being judged for that. And as though that these are things that are static, unchangeable, and that's part of who you are. And that's where the danger comes in. Whether it's positive or it's negative, it will play out negatively in different contexts. And it's really something that is not even scientifically proven. You don't have a race genes in you, right? It's something that is constructed and being given unto you. And even the most positive stereotype can act against you when the situation changes.
Right.
If you look at the Chinese person and you think that Chinese are all hardworking, how does that work against the Chinese person who is not successful? Or in certain cases, like we see in post-Suharto, in the Suharto period, during the fall of the New Order regime, people acted on their stereotype against the Chinese. Because they're hardworking, they are controlling the economy, and therefore we have to go after them. And it works against them in that situation. So let's move beyond stereotyping and look at the essential matter that we don't have this race.
That's a good one, because this question from our TikTok viewer, Dave So, asks, how do we overcome then, you know, racial or ethnicity stereotypes by society in general? I suppose one way is to, you know, nip at the bud, so correct someone, help them understand. But what else can we do?
I think it takes, you know, trying to find commonalities and not dismissing views as a whole. I think there is a tendency, I mean, coming from a Chinese family, to think of the older people in your family who speak about something really hurtful and dismiss them as an idea that is dying out and excluding them from the conversation. No, I don't think that's the right approach. I think meaningful engagement means talking to them, finding out where their context and their positions come from, and realizing where to meet in the middle, right? There are certain agreements and commonalities when you want to talk about race, and try to figure out what forms the basis of the stereotypes that they have formed, and question that. Sometimes it makes for an interesting discussion, right? Because you never know what your grandparent might have experienced back in the day, and it does open your eyes as well. But realizing that they are as much a part of the discussion as new generations with new values and mores, it's really important. And yeah, it's important to reach out.
Well, at this point, I just want to thank our viewers if you're just joining us. Today we're talking about racism, and of course, keep your questions coming. I also want to remind you that we have exciting prizes to give away. Remember, the question will be revealed at the end of the session. All you have to do, DM us with the correct answer, whether you are on TikTok or Instagram, and the first few people to message us will win these exciting prizes of a GrabFood voucher and a Google Home Mini, if you've always wanted that. Now we want to talk about something that you guys also brought up, about the spate of incidents, you know, increasing. It's, that's also because of, you know, social media, the avenues. So what then is the role of, you know, social media, or even the media, or the courts? What role should each party play, and how can we, you know, address these incidents in a responsible way?
Well, I'm not sure when it happened, but there seemed to be a reversal, you know, with the rise of social media. It used to be that racist incidents are first picked up by maybe a forum somewhere, and the media covers it, and then people react to it, right? the media covers it with a kind of a responsibility that it has, with a duty that it has to report certain things, but they're aware of the right vocabulary of what, how to address a topic like this. But somehow there has been a reversal with the rise of social media, right? Where everyone is a journalist, where people do post the experiences directly online. So social media has played a part in amplifying some of these incidents, and the virality factor does show, and really bring all these feelings up to the fore. And the media often has to play chase, right? But I think the interesting bit is that because of the rise of social media, we do also see interesting new perspectives coming in, right? New commentators who are not the usual types that the media go to come and lend new takes on an old topic like this. And you know, we've seen like the rise of certain platforms that have made it their task to curate and showcase some of these experiences, which I thought was a real interesting development.
So I think there's been a democratization, right, as is what you're trying to say, of media representations of this. And I think one way in which, you know, people can learn how to deal with this new media landscape is really, you know, to teach media literacy, right, so that people understand this landscape, you know, not to take everything we see as fact, as truth, but, you know, to understand that there might be many sides to a particular issue, but also understand that there is importance for this social media space, right? Because it gives people a space to express themselves and often to find community, right? To have their experiences legitimated by other people who might have experienced racism or discrimination in the same way, and often for marginalized groups or people to get their story told, because not everyone's voice is valued equally, right?
And so I think it's sort of given, as you said, marginalized communities that platform, because maybe, you know, someone is listening, or it is a platform for them to share what they may have been afraid to share before. So
yeah, I think we should not just focus on social media, because a lot of the thinking and the discussions are also offline, and that's one of my concern also. Are we guiding and discussing it in a way that is productive outside the social media space? And I think one missing element is actually in schools. I mean, young people are already talking about racism, but are the schools catching up, in the sense that are we opening up the spaces, safe spaces, for people to actually engage in issues of racism in schools? And part of the problem is that sometimes teachers themselves are not equipped to deal with this topic, and therefore it's better not to bring it up, because then they are not sure how to manage it, right? So I think the intervention has to be right from young at a school level, so that the moment people engage on social media, then there's already that literacy that Laavanya was talking about, not just media literacy, but critical thinking also, and understanding how media operates, the framing of issues, so that not everything is being funneled through just one perspective or one lens. I think that has to be through the education system that teach this.
Well, we're getting a lot of questions. In fact, I can't seem to follow my flow, because all the questions are great questions coming in from you guys on TikTok and Instagram. So I'm going to divert and come to this question. This one is from our IG viewer. Your thoughts on Chinese privilege, is it true that it's baseless? So I have to ask this one.
Laavanya has written a paper on that, so I'll let her answer it.
Okay, sorry, you have to go first then.
Well, I think, you know, firstly, there's a lot of discussion about Chinese privilege, but people might have different definitions of what we mean by Chinese privilege, right? So I think firstly, I want to, you know, put out there that Chinese privilege doesn't mean it's against Chinese people, or that, you know, and really when we think about Chinese privilege, we need to think about it at a structural level, right? About inbuilt structures in society that might favor a particular group over others. You know, just as we can think about gendered privilege, about ways in which our society has patriarchal structures, we can think about favoring of certain age groups. You know, similarly, we can think about privilege in racial or ethnic terms, right? So I think we should think about, you know, do we have structures that favor certain groups and don't favor others, right? And that's perhaps a way to start thinking about it, because it can be a very touchy topic, right? And you know, it doesn't imply that every Chinese person has the same amount of privilege, right? This is also, you know, different according to the kind of different intersectionalities as Imran was talking about earlier.
Yeah, so. I think we just have to get to the root of it and ask, before we even talk about Chinese privilege, we have to unpack and ask whether, can we agree that there's such a thing as privilege in any society or in any circumstances? I think the notion or the concept of privilege itself is something that we have to acknowledge first. And there are plenty of examples, and it doesn't mean that because someone has privilege, therefore they're trying to harm or they're trying to do bad things towards others. I have a privilege as a parent over my children. I mean, if I were to tell my children you have to go to bed by 10, they can't say no. Democratically, all my four children will say, no, we outvote you.
They'll probably say no still, right?
They'll probably say that, but I will still have that privilege as a parent to determine their bedtime, right? Even in sports, you know, you have the privilege of the referee to decide whether it's a goal or not. So privilege exists everywhere. And here we have to understand the intersectionality of things. There are privileges, not privileges, privilege as a concept that are attached to race, to your demography, whether you're in the majority or not, to maybe religion and many other factors. Now, if we see that as something that is normal, then we can try to unpack it a bit more and see whether structurally there are certain advantages being attached to a particular race, not because it's meant to be that way, but out of historical circumstances or many other circumstances that we have to talk about. And it's a very complex thing and it can be very touchy, so I agree that we have to be very careful about using this term even in public discourse, because not everyone will have the same understanding of what people are talking about.
Yeah,
I fully agree with the other panelists, and I wonder if the word privilege suffers from a sort of a bad rap, right? Because of the lack of understanding about what goes behind it. Perhaps there's a need to rebrand it and call it something else.
And one thing, I think we cannot use it as a conversation stopper.
Yeah.
Like, for example, if I disagree with Jun Sen, I cannot just say, you know, you should not talk about this because you have Chinese privilege. I think that's where the problem is, when we use it indiscriminately, without understanding, as a conversation stopper. Then it defeats the whole purpose of unpacking it.
Yeah. Also, one thing we talk about with, you know, being aware of, you know, what racism is, and all the incidents have sort of like help you understand a little more, you know, give you more understanding. So at this point, I have another question from our viewer. This one comes from TikTok. How do we translate awareness into action? Is it enough to just educate, you know, through, say, just social media? So, you know, this part about translating awareness into action.
I think following up what Imran said about schools and education, I think that's definitely the place to start. And because, you know, we talk about racial harmony in schools, for example, but I think we need to go beyond, you know, wearing each other's clothes or appreciation of each other's foods. And one of the things we could do is understand the struggles of different communities, right? So historically, as well as presently, you know, what were the what are the struggles of, you know, Chinese educated Singaporeans when we switch to a more English language medium, right? What are the kind of struggles that they faced in terms of getting jobs or employment? How were they disadvantaged? You know, how do women who wear a tudung, you know, how do they get stereotyped? And do they find it more difficult to find a job, for example, right? So I think a deeper engagement of issues would be one way in which we could go about this.
Yeah. That example that you brought up, actually, it has been an issue that we have been debating for quite some time, the allowing women to wear the tudung, the uniform. As a society, so then how do we hold, you know, such difficult conversations about racism?
Well, let me build on this point on awareness. Sometimes we talk about awareness as a one-way street, you know. It's like, okay, we are aware of a racist incident, of someone who is being racist, of racism in general. But I think awareness is also internal, is to interrogate ourselves and ask ourselves whether we have also done the same mistake, whether we have carried those stereotypes, whether we have acted in a racist manner towards others. And this is where I think beyond safe spaces where we talk about these incidents, and talk about racism in general, there need to be brave spaces where we actually ask ourselves and correct ourselves first also. And I think that kind of conversation is where we can be more thoughtful about this issue. So it's not just about blaming others, but it's also asking what we ourselves can do as a society, as an individual even, to correct this problem of racism.
Yeah, and just riffing off of that, you know, I mean, there is power within every one of us to correct something when we see that an injustice exists in the world, right? And that has given rise this year to the Call It Out movement. You know, people calling out things that they see, because being a bystander might make you actually complicit to the act, right? So that, therefore, I think you know, the ability to call out something when you see it being done to a friend or even to a stranger is really powerful. I think that's how you translate that sort of awareness into real action that can help someone.
Yeah, but how do you want people to call you out if you have expressed something that is racist, even though it's unintentional? So maybe that's something to think about, right? Because it's easy always to call out someone who is being racist. But if you are doing it, how would you want to be called out? And if it's done in a way that is very hurtful, you might even dig in and you will say, no, I'm not racist. And then you will flip it and say, no, you are the one who's being racist. And that's the kind of conversation that will not get us anywhere.
That's true. Yeah.
Right? So maybe the way things are being called out also needs to be asked. And whether it's done in a way to educate or it's in a way to make someone ashamed. And what's the consequence of just making someone feeling ashamed? Will it really make the person rethink and correct himself or herself? Or is it going to perpetuate the thing further?
Yeah.
I think, you know, at a kind of moving beyond individual level, though, at a kind of more structural level, you know, we have laws, we have policies, and I think more persecution, for example, of discrimination in hiring, in the rental market, you know, if we see more of that, that also sends a very strong signal that we will not tolerate this in our society. Discrimination based on religion or race or gender. So I think, you know, that's also something else we need to think about in terms of translating awareness into you know, more action and better outcomes.
And also, you know, at that point, we also have this a new Maintenance of Racial Harmony Act that is going to be introduced soon. So this one has more like light touch approaches of getting the offender to, you know, make an apology, getting them to go through, you know, an experience with, basically trying to get that person to understand instead of, like, you know, slapping a fine or stuff like that. So do you think that is enough, or do we need more? Can your legislation do more?
Well, I think there are some precedents already with you know, a lighter touch approach to law. I mean, there were amendments in the Maintenance of Religious Harmony Act that introduced a new community remedial initiative. And what it does is exactly as you've described it, right? Allowing the person who caused the offence to meet the community that they have harmed and coming to a middle ground, right? That they can, and so that the offender can realise that maybe he or she has erred in their ways. And in place of that, you know, you don't take out legal, like you don't charge the person in lieu of prosecution, essentially. Of course, the act has not come into force, but perhaps that's where the new legislation is coming from. And I thought it was brilliant that, you know, there are these forms of restorative justice, rather than just looking for punitive ways to try to regulate acts like this. Because the truth is that a lot of it does come out of ignorance, right? Yes. And restorative justice allow you to address that factor at its core, to allow people the chance to come together and realize that, hey, actually what I've been doing is wrong. And society actually watches that and heals as a result. I think we remember all the incidents of the past year and feeling very angry, but we often forget how it usually ends, right? How these incidents just fade from the memory, and it often ends when the offender realizes the error of his ways and apologizes. maybe for some acts that is not enough, there is still a need to take out punitive action at times, especially when you do want to protect society at large, to prevent something from really, prevent enmity from really causing hurt to the rest of society. But restorative justice like these actually do go a long way.
Well, we're about more than halfway through the session. I do want to bring up another point of our finding. This is a little different. It's about multiculturalism in Singapore, you know, and that concept changing and evolving here over time. So take a look at this chart on religious identity. So just bear in mind, these respondents are they practice a religion, so just so 48% of these respondents say that the identity is closely tied to their religious community. 40% say their closest friends are from their religious community. So the question I have for you is, what do these statistics say about the changes in demography and inter-ethnicity?
Yeah, I personally find the finding quite interesting, but of course there's a lot of unknowns also, because how does that intersect with ethnicity, for example? So when they say their closest friends are from a particular religion, and in Singapore, religion and ethnicity is quite closely tied for many communities. Let's take the Malay Muslim community, for instance, right? So it's closely linked, being Malay and being Muslim. And at the same time, also, the other factor we have to think about is how religion is being understood. And a lot of aspects of religion is being practiced culturally. And therefore, it will not be surprising if you say someone who is closest to you as a friend is from the same religion because of the cultural affinity that the person might have, and it makes things easier to go out and eat a certain food or to do certain things together because of that cultural affinity. So it does not say anything about whether a person is being intolerant or being discriminatory against others. It just speaks about cultural affinity that is expressed through the religious identity. I mean, that could be one factor that we have to think about. It could be many other reasons.
And it would be interesting to watch how this particular question, this finding, would also change over time. And that's when you know how things are going, you know. But I think the findings do show that religion is still important to many people. As a means of finding people they have an affinity to, like what Imran said. But also, we also do need to recognize that society is never stagnant and it does change over time. And because of that, you know, maybe that brings up certain questions and assumptions about certain frameworks that we need to revisit to see whether they still apply.
So I'm going to say that you're talking about the CMIO, Chinese, Malay, Indian, others framework. I mean, something that we talked about prior to, you know, the session starting is that you see a lot of mixed marriages these days, and in fact that's only going to grow. In fact, we also see a lot of people moving to Singapore and Singaporeans moving out. So then this concept of CMIO, is it still relevant then?
Yeah, I think it needs tweaking, right, to reflect the growing diversity of Singaporeans. So, you know, inter-ethnic marriage is on the rise, and also, as you said, marriages between Singaporeans and foreigners, right? So we see this diversity, for example, within ethnic groups. So within the Chinese group, within the Indian group, we see much more diversity. So with the Indian group, for example, we see a lot of immigrants who are becoming naturalized and changing the composition of the Indian community. So it's becoming less Tamil-speaking, the socioeconomic status of the community is on the rise. So can we really say that this community is Indian in the same way anymore, right? Similarly, with the Chinese community, we've seen intra-ethnic tensions, so within the community, between, you know, local born versus foreign born, Chinese Singaporeans. So can we then talk about this group with the same label of Chinese anymore, right? And similarly with mixed race marriages and children from mixed race marriages and families, how will they identify, right? Because in the end, you have to identify with one group when you are applying for a HDB flat, for example. So even though you might have double barrel ethnicity on your IC, you still have to identify with one. So how do we deal with this increasing complexity? Are the tools of CMIO as governance tools, do they still work in the same way, or can we tweak them somehow? And eventually, maybe in the long term, can we also maybe dismantle and do away with them? Right.
Yeah. I think that's the whole point about multiculturalism. Of course, on one level, at the most basic factual level, it is just diversity across the human race. But multiculturalism is also about governance. And we must not forget that even CMIO has its own history. So the complexities are already there. It's not something that is becoming more and more complex. No, we were as complex in the past as it is now. I mean, before CMIO was introduced, you don't think of yourself as Chinese in that monolithic category, right? It's about where you come from, you know, from
Teochew,
Hokkien, you know, and all various parts. And even Malays are not just Malays, they are Javanese, they are Bugis and Banjaris, etc. But for the purpose of governance, it's just that identity is being put together and it becomes CMIO. But now, of course, things are moving further and you see a lot of intermarriages. And therefore, we have to tweak the whole thing and find a better way of managing the complexities on the ground without forcing people to be in a particular category, especially for those who are coming from mixed marriages. We have in the past, for example, a lot of complexities that occur because, you know, like Chinese parents are giving away children to Malay families. And there's a lot of intermarriages that happens between those who come from India and the local Malay population. You have the Peranakan category and a lot of other diversities. But those got lost, even dialects also. And now I think younger people are more interested in this kind of lost histories. And I think that's very interesting and very nice to find them digging up more of these complexities and looking at their own complexities now. And I think eventually the policy has to catch up.
I mean, it has always, the government has always insisted that, that CMIO is used as a policy tool, like what you expressed, you know, to try to track changes over time, as well as to implement policies like your HDB ethnic integration policy, which has gone a long way in history, and maybe as time goes on, we still do need to revisit from time now and then. But the question is really, like, if you do want to tweak it, how then would you add to the many, many boxes that are already out there? You know, CMIO is four, and should we let the O factor balloon until it's so big as the culture, as our culture, multiculturalism evolves? So I think the point is that there is still a use for this tool, and taking it away does not immediately transform all of us into a kind of a race-blind society, because we can visually see that each of us is different. But at the same time, you know, the policy does need to reflect what is reality, and as these boundaries and as people stop fitting into neat little boxes, then yes, tweaking is necessary.
And one way to overcome it is actually to start highlighting the intercultural elements in our heritage, in our present reality. There's a Hainanese chicken rice actually belongs to the Hainanese or comes from Hainan, you know. Then there's just a lot of things. So if we can see ourselves as a mixed pot of many things, and then we can see a bit of ourselves in the other, and the other can see also that there's a bit of us in them, I think that's a better way forward, rather than this rigid category that if I belong to a particular race, then I define myself as being what I'm not. And that already draws a separation. But if I can see myself as being part of that interaction, that connection, that engagement with you, who happens to have a different cultural heritage, then I can partake in that also. And it becomes a shared cultural identities.
Well, I'm getting quite a few questions actually on, you know, educating the older generation. Sorry, this is going back to what we talked about. I think people really want to know this. How this is from a viewer on Instagram. So how do you think we can educate the older generation about racism? Do we teach about assimilation or integration? I think this is something that, you know, do you guys have practical tips that how to broach the topic without getting an earful or, you know, making things awkward in the family with, you know?
I think educating the older generation, wow, that's an interesting way to really put it, right? But I think it's what's needed is to hear perspectives across generations, to try to understand where are certain things that they might have a basis of belief, where their beliefs are based on, and to try to address why things have maybe changed, and not to educate them to say that, you know, this way or that way is right or wrong. I think having a safe space for such discussions also involve a lot of listening as well, listening to what they have to say about their own lived experience, because everyone can become a victim of racism, and maybe they have as well in the past. So it is needed to try to listen to what they have to contribute to this topic as well.
I think we should not just dismiss the older generation. I think there's a lot of wisdom also that we can garner from a generation that has actually had lived through the difficult period. And see how, and they saw how racism had panned out. So we need to listen to that story also and draw lessons and wisdom from that generation. But at the same time, of course, things have changed, and the new experience also needs to be conveyed to the older generation. Like, for example, racial jokes, right? I mean, it's fairly common in the past, and you get older generation telling, you know, the last time we joke about this and it's not a problem. Why are you saying that it's racist now, right? Maybe the younger generation can take some time to actually explain in a nice way. Personally, you know, sometimes I just let my children do the education part to the grandparents, and, you know, and I stay out of it. Because, you know, when the grandchild say, hey, grandma, you are racist, the grandma will not be offended. But if I were to say it, maybe it's a bit closer in generation, and it's a different experience. So there are many ways, and I think each family has to just find their own ways.
I've heard Imran talk about the issue of harm before, right, in a different setting, and I think that's perhaps one way in which we can also think about it, you know, conveying that this might make someone feel hurt or harm, right, and do we want to cause that? Perhaps it's a principle to convey as well, and I agree completely, you know, Jun Sen, what you're saying, we need to have conversations, because you cannot convince someone by saying you're wrong, right, but you have to listen to where they're coming from and to try and understand why they have certain opinions and convey that, you know, these might be harmful under certain circumstances.
Sorry, just one point. You know, because language plays a very important role. And language also evolves and has changed over time. And there's one particular word that is being used in the Malay community. It's fairly common. Pardon me, but the word keling, for example. The older generation might not see that as something that is racist, because the roots of the word actually is someone comes from Kalinga. You know, and it's fairly common to call someone who comes from that part of the world as being keling. But of course, over time, it evolve into something that's pejorative. And of course, now it's pejorative and one should not use that term. And this is something that is good to have a conversation with, how language itself evolved, right?
Well, that's about the time we have for today's session. We have so much more to say, but we're very happy that you guys managed to share whatever you can within this short 1 hour. And also we hope that our viewers managed to get your questions through and that the answers that we got go some way in helping you form that your approach in dealing with these incidents. Now, before we go, we do have our quiz question that we mentioned earlier. So this question, all you have to do, remember, is to DM us with the correct answer, whether you're on TikTok or Instagram, okay? So this question is, a large majority of our respondents to the youth survey said that social media has amplified racism. Is this true or false?
That's all. All you have to do, message us with the correct answer. Remember, if you're the first three people to message us with the correct answer, you get to win $25 GrabFood voucher as well as that Google Home Mini. And the next five people to message us with the correct answer will win a $25 GrabFood voucher. I also want to say thank you so much for being here on a Friday evening and to our viewers at home as well as spending your time with us. Do join us again next Friday, same time, 8 p.m., TikTok and Instagram. And we will be then talking about attitudes on LGBTQ issues. Is there a new normal among Singapore youth? We have Sam Joe, who is a co-host of the SG Boys podcast, Matthew Matthews, Principal Research Fellow at the Institute of Policy Studies, and Yasmin Yaya, she's our Supervising Editor here at Today. Well, that's all from us here at Today. Thank you so much. Stay safe. We'll see you next week.